Good morning.
That's a good start.
You know, I was just saying, Rob moved me from the first day to the second day, and it didn't seem like a problem at the time. But I realized that the first speaker that took my place was going to talk about how IOT, the security around it, is flawed, and that basically you got to be really careful. And so I tweeted my wife and said, get rid of that IOT lock on the door and do everything else. And then the other part of that equation was that I realized that having the first speech on, or his first presentation in the morning on the second day, meant that the whiskey night last night was really not going to be a good idea. So as I told Rob, as the travel and everything got to me and did an early night, and unfortunately, Rob and I were tweeting to each other, talking to each other at about 3:30 in the morning this morning. So we're still acclimating. But my name is Jim Marous. I am the publisher, co-publisher of a publication called The Financial Brand. It is a daily publication that talks about retail banking, everything from fintech to innovation, from branches to cards. And been doing this for about, writing articles for the internet for about 10 years, 7 to 10 years, and for the Financial Brand for 4. In addition, I'm the owner and publisher of something called the Digital Banking Report. That's more of a deep dive into some of the issues that are facing the banking industry today. I'm a lifelong banker, and sometimes when I get in front of an audience and I say, you know, I'm a lifelong banker, I'm expecting people to go, you know, we're sorry for you, or I go, hi, audience, they go, hi, Jim, and, you know, through rehabilitation of being a banker. But what we're going to be talking about today is the Internet of Things. And to make the job a little bit more interesting over the last couple of weeks is that I'm presenting about the Internet of Things about a week and a half after the Consumer Electronics Show. So the presentation changed quite a bit because a lot of things were introduced, so we're going to go over some of those. So as we look at the overall industry right now, it goes without saying, as you all know, that the industry is changing faster and faster every day, which by itself on the surface seems to be okay, until you realize that in banking, the reason why people got into banking in the first place was to avoid change. I know when I started banking in way back in the dark ages, one of the reasons why people said, boy, working for the bank is a really great thing, is that you can work for a bank for your entire life, move up the corporate ladder, get more and more responsibility, and things aren't going to change all that much. That's why fintech is having challenge getting a foothold. It's because we're continually trying to present to people that don't really like change. They like talking about it. They like discussing it, they like saying what they'd like to do, but overall, bankers, by their own definition of why they took the job, are pretty much against change. And I was discussing before I came up here that the ongoing comments in the banking world, because I was both a banker and served the banking industry, is, but we never did it that way. How many times did that come up? All the time. Another challenge is that bankers, by their own legacy, love to add things to make things better. When you think about fintech, when you think about Internet of Things and everything we do, we're trying to take away steps. And the reality is, if we add things, we make things worse for the consumer. Everything we're doing right now is fueled by big data. Yesterday, Aubrey was nice enough to show one of our slides that we built from the Digital Banking Report. We just came out with our 2017 Trends and Predictions Report, which not only took about 108 people, and interviewed them about what we thought the trends were going to be, but we also surveyed 800 institutions globally to find out the top 10 trends. And if you had a little bit more time to look at Aubrey's slide, or you went to the Financial Brand and looked up 2017 Trends and Predictions, you'll see that all 10 of the predictions require data, require advanced learning, require insights. And if you don't have those, you're not going to be able to achieve what you're looking to achieve in the world of Internet of Things. Everything we're doing right now is fueled by the digital consumer. The challenge, again, in the banking world, is most banks and bankers see the digital consumer as this person, a millennial holding an iPhone or a Google phone. The big challenge there is that's not necessarily a digital consumer. I'll agree that the millennial is a digital consumer, but I know a whole lot of digital consumers that are not millennials. And the challenge is, we have to address all these different people. We're going from a place where the person was able to be defined by the device they used to how they live. And that's a big difference. We're not talking about devices anymore. We're talking about how a person wants to interact, how they want to engage, how they want to be treated. And our whole environment is not being defined by other banks. They are being defined by the Googles, the Amazons, the Apples, who know us, look out for us, and reward us on a daily basis. We're challenged by intense competition from fintechs in the banking world. What's interesting about that is we found out in the last 12 to 18 months is that the best environment, as Brett King brought up yesterday, is probably one where the fintechs and banks work together towards solutions, because both sides of the equation have gaps. And as we look at the Internet of Things, you bring a third element in that. You have fintechs, you have banks, and you have the technology producers. It gets more confusing and more difficult to make it all come together, but the key is, while the banks have the customer base and have the scale and understand regulations and certainly have the capital, fintechs have the knowledge, have the innovation, have the agility to move forward. What we're looking at overall, and if you think about banking and you think about any industry right now, the winners are making life easier. They're making banking easier. Look on your phone. If you have oily fingers like mine are, and you looked at the phone and you looked at what you tap, they're the easiest apps to use. I have a 14-year-old that lives two doors down from me that cuts my lawn. He came up to me this year and said, "Mr. Marous, can you do me a favor?" I said, "Well, what's that?" He said, "You know, in the past, you've paid me for my services either with a check or cash. Would you mind using Venmo?" So I said, or he actually asked, "Do you know what Venmo is?" I told him I try to speak on it every time, and that he has now gotten a permanent place in my presentations for asking that question. But the reality was I had to ask him, "Why don't you want cash or checks?" He says, "Because I don't want to go to a bank." That's a whole generation of people that say, "You want to make it easier? Put it in the bank for me." They don't want to carry cash. They don't want checks because both of them require you going someplace. They'd rather do it at home. So look at innovation through time, a little play on words. 1968, mainframe. We are talking about innovation in computers as a room full of key computers, whole rooms. Next one was, I think it's 1972, the Computer Society. As you can see, a computer was considered one of those nice calculators, which is kind of interesting. And then you look at the first year, the year of the machine, was the person of the year in 1982. Bill Gates, 1984. We have the cool devices in 2006. We have the man of the year, or the person of the year was you with a computer in 2008. You have in 2014, you have the smart home, you have the device computer with you all the time. And then last year in 2015, or actually 2 years ago in 2015, you have the virtual reality. Look at the difference. And you'll see that there's going to be faster and faster evolutions of that. Uh-oh. The Brett King, okay. That might be it. Yeah, that is it. Okay, good. What we're seeing is billions of interconnected devices. It is expected, and it's interesting. We continue as an industry to talk about 2020. 2020 is like 3 years away. We got to move that timeline forward. But in 2020, or actually in 2019, Google estimates that there'll be 20 billion devices worldwide. That, by the way, is somewhere between 4 and 6 devices for every person on Earth. This is actually a little bit dated, but it showed the number of devices and the usage of devices through a sensor. But what it means is, whether or not you want to or not, the reality of Internet of Things is going to happen, whether if we got on board or not. What we have to realize, though, is that when we're looking at the intersection of data, technology, we're really looking beyond the device. It's device agnostic. This is an example of one of the devices, which is a BMW, I think it's a BMW, yeah. It's a BMW key fob, the key code. They put it so you could actually make payments with your key fob. Why? Because actually, in reality, the phone is neat, but it's not necessarily convenient. If you're trying to get up and go someplace, or if you're going to the workout, wouldn't it be better to have it on your workout device, your fitness device, your payment capability, rather than carrying a phone, which is, in many cases, bigger than the wallet that it replaced? And smartwatches isn't necessarily the best answer. Because what we see is smartwatches were tethered to phones. So another example of an addition to make it easier to live. And the reality was, the reason why smartwatches have had a somewhat rough existence, much like Google Glass, is the technology preceded the solutions, the value. Brett brought up yesterday the fact that when you look at smartwatches, you look at fitness devices, the reality of what can happen and the beauty of the whole device is, if you can monitor my heart rate and all my blood sugar and everything else on an ongoing basis, the doctors can have a better idea of how to deal with me rather than a point in time. You add that to insurance and gamification, and you have the ability to build games for the consumer by their financial institution to get more fit. And what the beauty of this is also is that the ability to then at some point untether the watch. It's interesting, is, you know, how things come around, go around, is that I think most people my age or even younger than me got rid of watches probably 20 years ago. And then they introduced the fact that, hey, do you want to wear a watch? You're going, no, been there, done that. But bring value, and I will. So outside the watch, maybe it's more convenient. Maybe it's actually a payment ring. MasterCard introduced a payment ring. Visa actually had one at the Rio de Janeiro Olympics for all the athletes, where they can make payments simply by showing their ring. That's convenience. That's simplicity. That's a lifestyle decision. Amazon Dash. How many of you are familiar with Amazon Dash? Okay. So what these were, Amazon said, let's look at all the things that people reorder on a frequent basis. Let's allow them to put it near those things, and all they have to do is push the button, and they'll have them delivered to their house. And Amazon Prime members are the only ones who can get this because they get free delivery, and they'll get it within a day or so. So if I run out of, let's say, Bounty, I push the button. 2 days from then, the Bounty arrives at my house. Now, on the surface, that says, okay, pretty cool. I don't have to go shopping for it. It's for things I often do. But let's take this a step further. Amazon's not just fulfilling orders and trying to get the retail side of this. They're getting information. So if I had all these, they're going to know how often my cycle is, my purchase cycle. So the learning environment is the fact that I will no longer have to push the button. They're going to come to me the day before I push the button saying, I bet you're running out of Bounty. I bet you need some macaroni and cheese. Take the technology one step further than that, and let's have this device technology on a Brita water filter. And when the filter gets dirty, it reorders itself. The exact same technology. And, oh, by the way, that's a payments exercise. Because every time that happens, a payment's being made for that. Now, from banker's perspective, big red flag. Is the consumer even caring who's the payment taken out of? Where the payment's being made from? No, it's invisible. So, for instance, if Wells Fargo is connected to my Amazon account, how hard is it going to be for Bank of America to unseat them? How will they do that? So are the banks going to be at the control, being the driver, or are they simply going to be the passenger? And as these things get more and more integrated into our daily lives, how do you unwind that relationship? How do you make it where they even care about what bank they're working with? And as Brett mentioned yesterday also, he stole some of my thunder, but it's good. Or I steal his back, I guess. is the fact that, do people even care what their account is? Or if, by the way, if I'm low on balances, I want my device, my phone, whatever it is, to notify me that, you know what, you may want to deposit money in your account because you're getting, you know, short of funds. Not after the fact, but before the fact. So what did Amazon do? Amazon came out with a programmable dash. This can be connected to a number of technologies. What this is, it's the exact same technology saying, okay, we'll let you program what you want us to respond to and how you want it to be used. Again, it can be used for payments. How many are familiar with the Magic Band from Disney? Okay, so these came out 5 years ago. Initially, they're simply a neat device that you could use and you could take to the park and you could open your door and you can make payments with. Well, Disney has a really controlled environment. It's a gated community. So what they did is they have beacons all over the park. They know exactly who purchased or who took these bands. Now if you go to Disney, you walk in the gates, you use that to get in the gates. They have it connected to the FastPass program. So if there's rides that you want to get on, you no longer have to sign up for them. They come to you and say, by the way, given your family structure, which we have massive amounts of data on people like you, here's the things you should sign up for, and we'll notify you when they're available. My sister and her family, she has a 23 and a 26-year-old, went there. And what amazed them? Everywhere they went, they were identified. They went on a ride where they have photos or video showing, and it's all personalized to the people in the cart. Hey, Jeffrey, glad to see you're taking this ride. The Aerosmith ride, basically, they have rock posters made with a person. Now, for a little kid, what's amazing with this technology is the speaking characters will actually identify little kids by name, going, Susie, we're really glad you came to the park today. That's mind-blowing. But it's the level of personalization that they can do. And oh, by the way, those bands, it's not the future. The future is not to have bands. Maybe integrate with your phone or some other technology. But the amount of data they're collecting, you can find lost kids, you can do everything else. But this technology makes it so you can make payments easier. Everything's integrated. Oh, by the way, if you lose one of these, it's already integrated with your phone. You just push a button and it takes it offline. They give you another one. The AirPods. Most people saw this and thought, oh, it's a new listening device. Interestingly, what is interesting about these AirPods is the fact that it's actually a transmittal device. If you use Siri, this device is closer to your mouth and in the right position so that you can make Siri commands that are not going to be misunderstood. How many of you get frustrated when Siri starts making mistakes and it continually makes the same mistake over and over again because of ambient noise? This gets rid of that. Oh, they're also NFC ready in combination with the phone. So voice technology, I can say, purchase X and it'll take care of it. What it is actually more of a listening device than a listening device from listening to my voice. It's a voice-activated device more than it's a music-hearing device. There's more technology in these AirPods than there was in Apple's first iPhone. We've come a long way. VR Pay, Alibaba and Alipay. This is where you can actually shop with your VR goggles on without taking them off. How do I make a payment? Simply nod. Kind of scary for those of you who like shopping. So you go through a mall, a virtual mall. You go from store to store going, oh, I like that. I don't like that. Somewhere in the transaction, if you have a move-in account, it tells you that, by the way, you're running low on funds. Do you want us to replenish or transfer funds? But now think of this without the phone, without the VR device. Think of it with mixed reality. Or maybe you have simply it in glasses and you're walking around your house as you're shopping with the store mall or the store within your house and you're still doing the same transaction. Okay, so let's go a little bit further, a little bit in the science fiction area. The embedding of payments within clothing, gloves, jackets, or maybe a simple decal. It may not happen, but what we're getting to is the possibility to have embedded technology in combination with blockchain and identity to be able to say, you know what, I don't want to carry anything. I want you to know who I am wherever I am. The smart home. What's interesting about the smart home is that all the devices not only talk to each other, but they fulfill themselves. So for Christmas, for my own gift, I bought some IOT plugs and light bulbs. So now, right now, I could freak my family out by dimming, turning on, or turning off a light bulb, by turning on or off the TV. But from a security standpoint, think of how powerful that is. If I'm in different time zones and I want to make it so that I don't have my lights going on at exactly 8 o'clock every night, but I vary it. Oh, and by the way, when the light bulb gets close to being burned out, it notifies me that it's time to reorder. So now we have combinations of light bulbs and banking in one item. They're very cool, and it's going further and further. Groceries. This is one from CES. This is the Family Hub from Samsung and MasterCard. It's a rather expensive refrigerator that not only keeps track of what groceries you need and want, but orders them for you, and you push a button for payments. Now, right now, it doesn't have the sensors in the refrigerator to automatically order based on how much you have left. But let's take this technology one step further. How about pantries? Anybody who's been to Las Vegas realizes if you move the M&Ms or the bag of chips or water, it will automatically charge you simply because you moved it. Think of a practical use of that, where you have sensors throughout your pantry that will reorder based on when you run short of something, automatically. Combine that with Amazon technology, and it will deliver to you within an hour or 2 hours, possibly by drone. Again, payments are invisible. I haven't talked payments very much except to refer to the fact that they will be bought. But you don't see a credit card here. It's all integrated already. My wife and I went shopping this Christmas, did all of our Christmas shopping in one night. It was a very snowy night in Ohio. My wife was on one side of the kitchen table, I was on the other side of the kitchen table. And we got on our computers and we have something called Check Twice, which is a really old-fashioned kind of Amazon program that allows you to make family lists, get what people want on their list, have it checked off for those people except the person who asked for it. And so you're no longer picking up the phone all the time and saying, who's got what? And they're all integrated to the online, usually to Amazon. My PayPal is integrated with my Amazon. We did all of our shopping within 4 hours at the kitchen table. And then we went to the malls and enjoyed watching people shop.
And so how does this work? That by 2020, 50 billion things will be connected to the internet, the equivalent of 6 devices for every person on the planet. That's the power to transform your home into a connected family hub. And now, Samsung is partnered with MasterCard to develop a new commerce application and a smarter way of shopping for groceries right from your refrigerator. Introducing Groceries by MasterCard. Experience seamless ordering from multiple merchants, where you can add everyday items to your intelligent cart and pay with a single secure checkout. Keep your fridge well stocked and your home happy with Groceries by MasterCard.
So again, you look at this, and is this going to be taken up really quickly? Probably not. I mean, how many times do you replace a refrigerator? It's right now a fairly costly device. But how about if Amazon or somebody says, we'll fund some of this. We'll bring the cost down. We'll have automatic integration. We'll make it so that your groceries get ordered. They get delivered by Amazon through any grocery in the area, but it's delivered by either Amazon or, let's say, Uber, paid for, and on your doorstep. Seamless. I don't know many people that love going to the grocery store or going to the store for anything other than something you want to buy immediately. So what this does, it takes it out of that. Okay, do we lose this presentation? We'll try. Okay, there we go. Okay, we've talked a little bit about it. The number one device at CES, or the number one name at CES this year was Amazon. They got it together. Why? Because they're not a shopping and retail company. They're an information company. Amazon Web Services is the largest provider of cloud data storage in the world. They are 14 times larger than the number two firm. What do you think they're doing with that data? They're processing it and finding out more about who we are. I have multiple Echoes in the house. You have to be careful where you put them. You may want to change the name of it because I've had a couple things almost ordered by commercials on the TV. It does happen. But more importantly, when I wake up in the morning, I'm always starting my day talking to my Echo, talking to Alexa. Alexa, what's the weather going to be like today? Alexa, can you tell me where I should go for dinner? It learns. It's getting better and better at learning. Amazon the future is not going to be a listening and responding device. It's going to be a personal assistant, as well as other devices like this. So when I wake up in the morning, all I would have to say is, good morning, Alexa. Alexa will say, good morning, Jim. Today's weather, because she knows that I like to know the weather, is this. Your sports scores on your favorite teams are this, 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 and this. Today, you have an appointment with Brett King. I've sent you some information on your email about what's been going on with Brett King recently. Do you want to go to the same restaurant with Brett today that you did last time, or do you want to pick another one that's like what you usually eat at? Do you want me to make a reservation for you? By the way, the money in your account today is X. By the way, this already exists at Capital One. The money in your account is X. Do you want to transfer any money from credit card to deposit account? You're running a little low. Your investments currently stand like this. Two of your investments have shareholder meetings today. One of your other investments, reading came out on them, and we think that you might want to change your holdings in that company. It's going to rain today. Do you want me to remind you 5 minutes before you leave to take an umbrella? Do you want me to order you an Uber? By the way, your wife said she wants lasagna tonight. Do you want me to order the ingredients and to have the menu emailed to you? The technology to do all of that is there today. Again, there's probably 6 or 7 financial transactions within that communication. Using your voice is a lot easier than typing. To be able to integrate and to communicate with Alexa or whatever the voice first device is going to be is pretty amazing. A friend of mine, Brian Rommel, is working with some hotels where you'll be able to walk in your room. It will identify who you are ahead of time. You walk in your room without a key card, but with your phone. When you get to your room, the device will ask you, are these the things you want to do? Pretty cool stuff.
おはよう。おはよう。あ、今日雨が降るかもしれないから傘持って行って。急がないと遅刻しちゃうよ。行ってきます。行ってらっしゃい。気をつけてね。
家で誰かが待ってるっていい番だな。さっき思ったんだ、帰ってくるとき。おやすみ。
おやすみなさい。
Okay, so this is the first time I've shown that video to a bunch of bankers, but it's really a little strange and a little scary. It's a little too maybe sexual, the whole point. What is interesting, and Brett, you can maybe confirm this, I believe this is currently available. It's in the first iteration. What? A prototype. Now, let's take out all the innuendos and the fact that this guy's going to be lonely the rest of his life. Well, maybe he won't be. Maybe he's going to be happy. But let's look at what that can mean, where you humanize the device. It's going to happen. How are you going to be engaged in that whole environment? Platformification, Aubrey showed it yesterday in one of the slides. Are you going to be the center of that universe or on the outskirts, just dumb rails? So we look at, you can't do one of these presentations without including Uber. But I want to give you a case study or a personal experience. I was in New Orleans in February this year. And in New Orleans and through Hilton, you can actually order an Uber through Hilton to have ready for you when you get to the airport. And they track your flight, so you don't have to come out of the airport and get an Uber. It will be waiting there for you. So I did that. I got in the car. It was waiting for me. I knew which one to look for. I got in the car, and about 3, 4, 5 minutes later, Hilton contacted me and said, "Glad you're on the way. We've already checked you in. Your phone will be used as your entry to the room. Hope you enjoy your stay." It's a pretty nice surprise and delight. By the way, already prepaid on my credit card. I went about another 10 miles, and Uber Eats, which is Open Table, contacted me and said, "Do you want a restaurant to eat at near your Hilton reservation? We have 3 choices for you." That was cool. Oh, and by the way, I was able to check out and have the car waiting for me at the designated time that I had set up. But that's a completely integrated engagement that everybody's trying to mimic. Now Uber gets better and better. So they're learning now. I don't know how many of you have gotten the notification that they now will tell you best traffic pattern, which way to go, where the shortcuts are. I found out today, I'm fairly new here, a couple days, and realized that trying to talk to a taxi driver about 35 Aberdeen, I should have been talking a foreign language, but that's exactly, I think, what he wanted me to do, and I wasn't doing very well. I got in 2 cabs, and they looked completely clueless, and I'm describing where it is, central business, and they're just, I'm going, you know what, I should have stuck with what I know. I order an Uber, the guy gets there, you know, he may not know where it is, but at least he's got a map, and a totally perfect experience, rather than take the risk. Oh, and as I found yesterday, taking a cab without any Hong Kong dollars, I basically bought a family with a $20 US bill. I think I bought them the cab ride, dinner last night, and maybe some clothes at the store because I had nothing else in my wallet. So I said, and I had to show them the exchange rate going, "You're getting a good deal. There's an easier way." But how about a new mobile banking app? As you have autonomous automobiles, you're going to need the ability to keep yourself busy. So the integration of voice-activated commerce within your car is going to be part of the equation. 67% of cars that are going to be ordered next year will have integrated technology, Wi-Fi technology, either through Google, through Amazon, or through other, that will be integrated within the automobile. Now, it's fairly simple. You can get your emails or things of that nature right now. But let's put sensors on the cars. Let's say you want to pick up some takeout, and your car shows up in the area with the beacons, and the food comes out to you. You don't have to order it. Or you drive through to go to a gas station, and you don't need a card or anything because the gas pump is identifying your car. It knows who's it. You need to fill up the tank, they'll fill it up for you. All that integration. Now I know why she's going. Okay, I've been wondering why she goes in front quite a bit. It's because everybody runs overtime, and there's a little alarm that you hear. So that's good to know. If you're looking at mobile banking app, this is really the future. Again, you don't need phones. You simply have the mobile in the car. It's quite nice. So take that experience, the Uber experience, and take it to restaurants. An interesting name for an app, I believe, is Dine and Dash, which is actually what they call the process if you go to a restaurant, order a bunch, and then book out of there before you pay. This is better, very much like an Uber app. You go in there, you have your meal, and you still leave without paying. It's paid for you as you leave. That's, in many cases, at a busy restaurant or a bar, that's a really uncomfortable user experience, is the payment process. If it's automatic, and I know it's going to be paid for just when I leave, I can walk and go in and go out as I please, it's really a good experience. Let's take integrating mobile payments with contextuality and convenience. This is South Korea. This is a video wall on the subway where you can take a picture of the items you want, and they will have them ready for you at your train stop down the line. That's better than going to the market, all paid for ahead of time. Or let's do Amazon Go, brand new. There's one grocery store now in Seattle. But again, we all in the United States like the, take care of it yourself and check out, where you don't have to go through a long cashier line. How about if you don't go through a cashier line at all? You walk in, you take items off the shelf, and between sensors and beacon, it knows exactly what you've taken. If you put it back, it knows you put it back. It knows if you put it back in the wrong location, it'll call a service member. It keeps track as you go along. You don't have to scan it. It's automatic. It knows what you purchased. And what happens then, you just leave. It's done. Now again, it's Amazon driven. The largest category of retail that is currently not online driven is groceries. It's a very low margin business. Brett talked to you yesterday about the fact that, you know, banking's got to squeeze the margins a little bit. How much do you think it squeezes the margins when you have no need for a cashier? How easy is it to go to Amazon Go? Oh, and during that whole process, Amazon is collecting information on what you personally are buying. Why? Maybe get rid of the grocery store and make it so that it will automatically know what you need in your household, and it will order it for you or prompt you and say, do you want us to deliver it to your house today? Or in an hour. Connections without devices. Okay, so you're getting really futuristic, but in the house, when you look at mixed reality and things of that nature, the ability to simply have the environment around you in the comfort of your home. Again, we need a lot of security to have this happen, but what we see in movies, it's amazing how much of it comes true. Not science fiction anymore. And as we talked about, the ability to have frictionless security. It's a key point. I think blockchain has a big role in the Internet of Things, in that you'll have the ability to have the blockchain actually do the identification, the universal identification. We're way away from that, but we have to work towards that. Kowloon, bring it a little bit local. Take this to a bigger environment, the smart city, the one that's interconnected, the one that is sensing you all over, both from a security standpoint and to make your life easier. There's a lot of investment being made in a lot of cities to make them smart cities. Smart cities 5 years ago meant you had high fiber optic cable in the city, or you had Wi-Fi. Smart city today is a whole lot different, a whole lot grander scale. So what are the implications for finance, because I'm over my time, is you want to own the relationship. How much are we willing to give up in the financial services industry and not be involved? Are we going to be on the inside? Are we going to be the driver? Or are we going to be on the outside looking in? Is the Amazon, the Googles, the retail store, the devices, are they going to own our relationship? Or do we want to keep that relationship? And maybe there's no reason why a bank can't be the provider of Uber services. It's already happening. Second, ability to apply data analytics. I've been in the banking industry forever, and we've talked about data analytics for 40 years. We need to start using analytics for the benefit of the consumer as opposed to the benefit for great reports. my biggest frustration is the amount of information that's known within a financial institution today is great. Unfortunately, the consumer doesn't know it. One really quick case study. So while I got here, 5 minutes after I got to Hong Kong, I got notified by Wells Fargo that my card had been breached. I said, no, it really hasn't. I just landed in Hong Kong, and I should have called you ahead of time. They said, no. Did you purchase 257 items over the last 6 hours? That's why, by the way, Brett, that the ATM didn't work for me. I was worried I had no money, and I didn't. Basically, through robotics, somebody hit 257 sites to try to purchase things. Wells caught it, shut it down before it went too far. So that's painful. But then, now I've had a Wells account for 15 years. Then I say, well, can you tell me where I've had card-not-present transactions so that I can contact the people where my card's connected and tell them that it's changed? They go, no, we don't really have a way to do that. I'm sorry, 15 years, you know exactly what I've done every day for 15 years, but you can't share that with me. Now, that by itself is a bad customer experience. Well, she said, oh, your card will be delivered Thursday. It's being delivered today. That's great. I'm here. Okay, so what's interesting about that, though, at the end, was that she said, oh, by the way, though, we've already put the new card on your Apple Pay account. What better example of the left and right of a bank, the people that get it and the people that don't? You have your legacy bankers that have seven different divisions that touch my debit card transaction. In Apple Pay, you have one area that says, I think we know what he wants. I was not out of the airport before they had my card on my thing, and I could have paid with Apple Pay without being able to pay with my debit card. Are we going to get it? Design first engineering. We had one designer here today, yesterday. We could have probably had a lot more. Beyond the device, as I said, the phone's probably not going to be it, and cybersecurity is pretty important. So I appreciate your time. I'm sorry I went a little bit over.